Good morning.
Good morning.
So let's join me in the gathering song, We Three Kings. Y'all might think this is Christmas song, but it's
what? Epiphany.
It's Epiphany, yeah. It's when the wise men actually came. Oh, do y'all want to stand? Y'all can stand.
Kings of Orient are bearing gifts. We traverse afar, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star, wondrous star of night, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading still. Proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light. On Bethlehem plain, gold I bring to crown him again. Forever ceasing, ever o'er us all to reign. Star of one, star. Proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light. Since an offer have I, in crimson's a deity nigh, with prayer and praising all are raising, worship him God most high. Oh, star. Star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us by perfect light.
Far is fine, it's made up of few, creeps of light, a gathering moon, starring sign.
Star of wonder, star of light, star of royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light.
Good morning. Y'all can have a seat. We have a lot, we have a few announcements. So, obviously, on your bulletin, if you have this little, if you've brought somebody or if you have a special prayer request, please fill it out. Right after church today, we're having a super chili lunch for everyone. We're also at the end of service. Don't run out because we have our annual congregation meeting. And that's where Herb will come up. We'll pass out the roster of the new officers. We'll also pass out the proposed budget, and we just take a vote. On the back wall or the back credenza is one of these papers, and it shows for the year who's going to be worship leader, communion prep, elders, and deacons. And so that'll help a whole lot. Are they all filled or all the slots filled on everything? Okay, so pick one of these up because I'm sure everybody is on here somewhere. So be sure and pick one up and take it home. I have mine on my desk, at my office desk at home, so I can highlight it because we forget, you know. It's our turn to do this or to do that. It's going to take all of us pitching in. What other? Oh, we're going to have a Bible study.
Mm-hmm.
We asked, and Pastor Jimmy answered. Yay! So 23rd, we decided on 4:30. We can play with that, but we're going to see how that works out. It's going to be on Sunday afternoons. We'll meet the 23rd and kind of decide on the material and that kind of thing. So we invite, we urge you all to come and to bring a friend to join that. Oh, yeah, be thinking about possible subject matter, what book you'd like to study and that kind of thing. So that's all, really. We don't have board and all that until next month. So, all right, so we'll sing our call to worship song, You Are My All in All. It's in this little purple book. Searched me and know me. You discern my thoughts from far away.
Even before a word is on my Lord, you know it completely.
I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works.
How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. I try to count them. They are more than sand.
Let us worship God. You are the rock of our salvation, O God, the source of our strength. You are the fountainhead from which flow the living waters. When our souls thirst after righteousness, your justice sustains us. In need of encouragement, we behold your power and glory. We lift our hands in the sanctuary. With our lips, we praise you. We raise our voices in the company of believers and call on your name. Fill us now with your Holy Spirit and nourish us by your presence. Amen. Okay, so if the children will come forward, you guys can sing.
Jesus loves me, this I know. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes.
have some recording going on today. You're new to me. I'm not sure exactly what's going on. I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
I know Joanne Devenport.
Where are y'all from?
Okay. She didn't contact me or anybody.
Surprise!
So you're going to record it for what now?
It's for our special that we're going to do. And I talked to Joanne Wilson, and I believe she's supposed to know.
Who did you talk to?
Joanne Wilson.
Yeah, I know Joanne very well, but she didn't talk to me.
Oh,
how interesting. Well, I wonder why she didn't contact me. That is, I'm not too sure either. So the recording is going to be used for how will the recording be used?
It will be used for our special breaks, 15 minutes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. When is that going to be aired?
Towards the end of January.
Okay.
Yes.
So you're going to record our whole service?
Just a little bit of it, not everything.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes, I'll be moving.
All right. Are y'all all right with that? It's news to me. I didn't know any of this. I couldn't understand you. All right. If y'all are all right with it, I'm all right with it. Thank you. All right, as we come to a time of prayer, there's those that we do want to remember in prayer. You've got a whole list of them there. In particular, you want to remember Betty Fugit family as they prepare for her memorial service, which is going to be taking place the first part of February. Please remember her. Maria Hernandez and Balthazar Vera, they're doing well. There is a new Balthazar. And I got to go up and visit and to share with them a little bit, and that's beautiful. He's going to call him Little B, because there's a big B, him, and then the little B. I thought that was interesting also that we would be celebrating, and I mentioned that to them as I prayed with them, celebrating nativity, and one of the three kings was Balthazar. And I said, you got a Balthazar being born at Epiphany time. So I hope to be able to see them again soon, as soon as that baby's able to get out, and that may be a while. They're doing well. Baby looked good, and so did Mama. Maria looked very, very good. David Baum is having up and down days, so please remember him in prayer. It's a very difficult time for him with his illness. He hates having to not get up and move around. And that's hard for him.
Can he accept calls?
Oh, yes. Yeah, you may have difficulty because he has both the cell phone and the home phone, and sometimes the caregivers and he get confused about who's supposed to answer the phone. And so sometimes nobody answers the phone. So you'll have to kind of play with that a little bit and find out. Sometimes he's asleep and he's not answering the phone. They don't answer his phone. So I'd play that by ear. But he would love the contact, I know. Rita, as she gets ready for surgery, want to remember her. Her surgery is on Wednesday. Remember her in prayer. And I understand that the Holly Derrick is a former member or somebody who's been, is a member here that y'all know who she is. And I was just informed this morning that her husband had died. And so we want to remember her family in prayer also. Who else do you want to point out in prayer? Yeah. So many. Our prayers are that it climaxes and that it'll be over soon. Well, are that we'll be over this particular variant of the virus and then move on. Yes, ma'am.
I would like to pray for the teachers on my school who have strep, COVID, or stomach bug.
Yeah, the stomach bug too, and flu.
Yeah.
It's part of it too. Yeah. Yeah, lots. lots and lots of people sick. All right, anybody else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we love you so very much, and we thank you for touching the lives of those that are special in our hearts today, along with all those that are on this list, Lord. There's so many people we come in contact with who are dealing with the coronavirus, Lord Jesus, and with COVID, and also with so many who have faced loss in their family lives, Lord Jesus. Pray earnestly your blessing and help, Father, because that crisis has become a crisis in all kinds of ways, both an economic crisis for our nation and also, Father, a very important and difficult crisis for individual families dealing with difficulties. We only ask that you give us opportunity of ministry. I thank you for our church, and I thank you for the efforts that we make. I thank you, Father, for the faithful few, Father, who are a part of our congregation, who come out and are a part of this, want a fellowship with each other. Time that we're going to spend even today, Lord, and having some soup and some chili and sharing a little bit with each other. That's an important thing, too. God, we love you for fellowship, and we thank you for the fellowship of our body, and we ask earnestly blessing as we get out into the week, Lord. For through the week, we contact people, many who are unable to come, and some, Father, who are thinking about coming. And Father, there's so many out there who are making transition in their lives, and we pray for it too. We love you. Do your best for us. Now, even as you've taught us to pray, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing.
Bread of the world, in mercy broken, wine of the soul, in mercy shed, by whom the words of life were spoken, and in whose death our sins are dead. Look on the heart by sorrow broken, look on the tears my sinner shed, and be thy feast to us the token that by thy grace our souls are fed. Bread of the world in mercy broken, wine of the soul in mercy shed, by whom the words of life were spoken, and in whose death our sins are dead.
Would you stand together for the doxology? Lord, we love you so much, and we thank you for the giving that you do to us in response, Father, is our giving. Our offertory is an example of that. We give to you all that we are, and we ask humbly your help, Lord Jesus, as we continue to strive to serve you in the kingdom, Father, in all the places where we live and play and do our business and in where we work. We ask earnestly, Lord Jesus, your help also as we reach out to our community and the variety of ways that we try to do your best through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, ladies. Hope you got something that'll help you. Bye-bye. Reading from Luke chapter 2, beginning with the first verse. Not the last time you'll hear the Christmas story, but perhaps the last time for a little while as we finish Nativity and finish also the Advent through our conclusion during Epiphany. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken in the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. Everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you the good news of great joy that shall be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." A surprise on that day in Christmas time, as we remember it, the birth of Christ. Almost as much a surprise as that was here a little while ago. Most people coming in to record it. I'll talk to Joanne about that. Joanne Davenport is a leader on the south side of Odessa in the black community. Many of you all may know her. But she is a good friend. She didn't call me and tell me that she was going to do this. So surprise, surprise, surprise. I don't know what she's doing. I'll find out, and I'll let you know when I find out what all she's doing with that. Like the great train of history, as we talked about as I began this series of history's mystery and the work of God in our lives leading us into righteousness being illustrated by a train. The process of God's mercy moving through time can't be stopped. It is big and it is strong. When I lived in Amarillo, there was an old steam train that was displayed downtown. Called it Old 5000. It was an enormous old workhorse train that they used back in the time of steam engines. The engine was probably as long as this building is wide. And as you approached it, it was as tall as a little bit taller than the balcony. It was an enormous structure. The wheels were taller than I on that thing. It was called the old workhorse because it was such a strong engine. As you walked toward it, you got the heebie-jeebies because it had such potential power on it, because it was a distance away as you walked toward it. But as you walked up to it, it got bigger and bigger. An enormous steam engine. Of course, it wasn't running. If it had been running, it would have been a lot more scary. But it was scary enough as it was. It had all this potential of power, and you knew that if that thing ever got started, stopping it would have been an enormous task. It was so very powerful. And so it has been also of the righteousness of God moving through history, through Mesopotamia, and Asia, and Europe, and then eventually to America. The engine of the revelation of God. And people have interpreted it a variety of different ways. How has God's revealing of himself been interpreted through history? For us, the story is still being, being written. How will the story be written in America? Several theologians have talked about how the work of God through his church is being interpreted in America. They see the time that we're spending in freedom of religion as being a pivot of Christianity. Christianity flourished when it was persecuted. People couldn't wait to get to church, an opportunity to share. And the reason, because there was persecution. Isn't it funny when people tell you not to do something, you really get mad, like taking a shot? You need to take a shot. You're not going to give me a shot. That's the American spirit, I guess, and I kind of like that. We are breezy, self-confident, particularly West Texans. We're breezy, self-confident, as you notice with traffic. Red means stop. Not for me. Red means go, go, go. So also stop sign. Stop my sign don't mean, that means you stop. Let me through. We are breezy, self-confident people. We do what we want to do. Well, the revelation of God will be interpreted in its own way in the history of America. One theologian said, you know, the freedom that we have of religion is not really freedom of religion. It's the freedom of irreligion. We don't so much have the freedom of religion as we have the freedom not to be religious. And people joy in that. You ask somebody, if you do a lot of sharing, and I'm so many of you do, when you share with somebody a little bit about your faith, how interesting it is as a chaplain. For me, it's really interesting when I go into a new home and say, do you all have a pastor or a church that visits with you? We don't like church. We just love Jesus. Well, you know what? Jesus loves his church. You know, and if you know the master, then you really need to know the bride. You know, and you need not say nasty things about the bride, because it's Mrs. Jesus. It's not my illustration. It's his. The church is Mrs. Jesus, and you really need to be careful of what you say about it. When I was in college, I got really frustrated with the church, and was going through Bible school, and I decided what everybody needed to do was just hit the streets. All of us that were going into ministry, we just needed to hit the streets and just do street evangelism. That's all that we needed to do, not to mess with the church anymore, because the church was a failure in all that it did. And I went to see a very good friend of mine who was a pastor at First Baptist Church of Abilene. He's still a very good friend. Has gotten into his older years and lost his wife just a few years ago. And I contacted him a little bit after that. He's a very good friend. His name is James Flaming. He's a Southern Baptist pastor, and he was pastor of the First Baptist Church of Abilene for a long time. And then eventually went to Alabama and became the interim pastor, pastor emeritus of a big church there that sends out a lot of missionaries. He was pastor of that church there while I was going to Hardin-Simmons University, and I got concerned about the church, and somebody got concerned about me. He said, Jimmy, you need to really talk to somebody about this. Because, you know, your call to ministry is something that will always involve the church. And I said, well, it doesn't have to. You know, the church is not doing its job. We need to get out and just hit the streets and do evangelism. I said, you need to talk to somebody, and maybe you ought to go see Dr. Flaming. Well, I didn't know James Flaming, but made an appointment to go see him, and he agreed to see me, and I went to his office, and He said, Jimmy, what is your difficulty? And I said, well, I don't think I have a difficulty. In fact, maybe you have the difficulty. The difficulty is you're pastoring a church, and the church is a fantastic failure. We have failed the Lord Jesus. We have failed in his mission to the world. The church isn't doing its job. Very patient, very wise man. I've always gone to him for advice about a variety of different issues because he is such a wise, wise man. He said, Jimmy, you have your own opinion, and that's in America. You're free to have your own opinion about things. But he said, I need you to understand something, is that when you're dead, the church will still be here. You need to know that. Your death won't make a difference at all. The church will still be here. And you need to be careful what you say about Mrs. Jesus. I said, I've never heard it put that way. And he said, I didn't put it the way Jesus did. Jesus said the church is his bride. And I would suggest strongly you be careful what you say about Mrs. Jesus. And I said, gosh, I guess I really need to be. And he said, yes. And he said, you need to invest your life into the church if you're going to be involved in ministry. You do what the Holy Spirit leads you to do. But know this, the church was established by the Lord Jesus. And it is his bride and it will always be there. You'll always, of necessity, have to work through it. In fact, he even said that when he comes back, he's coming back to get his church. That which is his bride. So be careful what you say about it. Know that the revelation of God comes through it. And I've built my ministry on that. 50 years of pastoring churches. And the church is important. It'll always be important. We continue to work in the church. Does that mean that I'm not involved in parachurch activities? No, I am. There's a lot of parachurch activities that I enjoy out there. For example, this last week, they call me every year to be a counselor at the rodeo. Because the cowboy church, you know, as the variety of cowboy churches are independent churches, and many of them aren't even established churches. Many of those evangelists in the rodeo circuit, they simply go from rodeo to rodeo and they preach in the arena as they have opportunity. But I always support that youth night at the rodeo. And even this time, it was lower in attendance, but I had the opportunity to be one of the counselors to go back and help some of those young people understand what it is to follow Jesus, to become a Christian. Young girl that I got the chance to counsel with, she attends a church with a pastor. The youth minister is a very good friend of mine, and I made sure he came back and knew that she had made this decision before I went over and prayed for the rodeo, because I get to pray also. I'm one of the prayers for the rodeo. And so I got to pray for the rodeo on Thursday night also. I support that as a parachurch ministry, but it's not the church. I support that when Billy Graham was involved in his evangelistic ministry, and the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association still exists with his son Franklin in charge of that. I support the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. I believe in multimedia evangelism. I believe in mass evangelism, but it's not the only thing. And it needs the church. You and I probably have had the same experience, and after a big revival that's taken place and a whole bunch of people have made professions of faith and made decisions, to find out that none of them ended up in churches. That's been my experience too often. It needs to be followed up on. They need to find themselves involved in the church. The last thing I told that girl as I was sharing, that young lady, I said, all right, there's five things. Look at your hand. She lifted her hand. I said, your hand will remind you of the things that you need to do to grow as a Christian. You need to pray. You need to read the Bible. You need to attend church. You need to fellowship with Christians and share your faith with others. That's discipleship in the Bible. I gave her a passage. Looking back, Romans 10:9 is that good passage. I said, how do you know that Jesus is mine? You look in Romans 10:9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I said that Bible gives you the assurance of it, and your church will become a family that is an extended family of what you have, and it'll be important to you all of your life. The revelation of God is in the wisdom that he has decided to establish the church. Creation of man in God's likeness was wisdom ultimately personified in Jesus. And then Jesus lives in us and works through us. Birth of Jesus, with God taking the initiative to bring peace, the peace of God, the righteousness of God into being. The uniqueness of Christianity is the birth and life and resurrection and second coming of Jesus Christ. God is sovereign. He's in charge. and all events are under His direction. Good scholarship is important when it comes to studying the Bible, for example. I'm old enough, and you are too. How many times have you had some evangelist write a book and said, Jesus is coming back? I still remember one when I was in college said, Jesus is coming back in 1988. And then he gave 88 reasons why Jesus is coming back in 1988. And then in 1992, he wrote a book and gave 92 reasons why Jesus didn't come back in 1988. Jesus is going to come back when Jesus is ready to come back. And you and I will still be surprised when that event takes place. It'll be in a day and a time that we know not of and no one else knows of. God is sovereign. It's up to you and I to study, and just a good study of the Word, a competent study of the Word helps us to keep that in mind always, that fact of Jesus coming is important, but how he's going to be coming back is something you cannot describe. A theme of God's revelation to us is his transcendence of himself through difficulty and trouble. That's a part of God's revelation. God reveals himself through trouble and difficulty. That's a hard thing to accept. It's a very difficult part of our discipleship. Very difficult part of discipleship of a Christian is learning that hardship and difficulty are a part of the journey. I still remember a good friend of mine that I met on the street one day when I was a young person here in Odessa, and he had become a Christian, and I saw him on the street, and I said, where are you going to church now? And he said, well, I don't go to church. And he says, I'm not getting what I need in a church. And I said, you need to be in church. You need to be in church. You need to find a church that will help you to grow and to be what you need to be. He said, well, you know what? There's just been too much trouble and too many difficulties. I'm not sure whether it's worth it. Churches have trouble. I said, they sure do. He said, my church split, and that's why I'm not going back to it anymore. And I said, you need to, because they need you. You need to go back to it. Churches are going to split from now on. Churches are going to have difficulties from now on. People are going to have difficulties from now on. There will be disease and trouble and death. All of those things that come on us, that is a part of discipleship, is transcending those things, is seeing God reveal himself through those things. Someone will ask me, as they did even in a letter that I got this last week, I'll get a note from somebody who I did a memorial service for, and they'll say, we appreciated it so much. You did such a good job in memorializing my father. I don't know how you do this. I'll tell the person, you don't know how I do this. I said, this is the way God reveals himself to us. Death happens, but death is not the end for the believer. For you and I, death is a transcending into the ultimate of God. For you and I, trouble is a transcendence in finding God always adequate for us. The theme of the Bible is that there are dark days and light days. God sees us through both. He will reveal himself. That's the sovereign wisdom of God. It's hard to understand. It's hard to explain to another person that the difficulties and the troubles that they're having are a part of the stewardships that come from God. All God's interested in is how you deal with it, not what it is. How do you deal with it? There's all kinds of troubles. It's not the trouble that came, it's how you deal with it. In counseling, that's a theme of my counseling, because a person will come and say, my marriage failed. I guess my life is just over. No. You've got trouble. But you know what? God can transcend this. God can transcend this and give you new meaning and new life. I lost a family member. I lost the leader of our family. I lost a person that was precious to me. That is a tragic thing. But this tragedy is a stewardship from God. You wouldn't have had it happen to you unless he believed you could handle it. You need to know that. God believes you can handle it. It's how you're handling it is what he's interested in. It's not what it is, but how you handle it. I love C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis would travel around to the RAF camps, preaching, encouraging people during World War II. And people would often say, the soldiers would say, you know, we need to be reconciled to God. And it was C.S. Lewis that said, no, not really. God needs to be reconciled to you. You need to keep seeking God until he shows you and explains to you why you are an RAF air flyer and why there's a world war going on. God is responsible for explaining that to you in your personal life, and you have to seek it out. Daniel experienced it. We don't have time today because I want to eat chili, don't y'all? Here in a little while. The book of Daniel. Daniel and all of those of the young men of Israel were transported over to a foreign land. And it was Daniel that said, God is doing something in this. The important thing is not what happened, it's what are we going to do with it. We are in a foreign land and we are prisoners here. It's not that it happened. The important thing is, what are we going to do with it? Why are we here? Let's find God's will in it all. We live in sinfulness, waiting to be delivered, and sometimes we have to be brought low to be brought high. Most people don't want to hear it, but you know it. When someone, this last week they did it, someone said, you know, I have a family member that's just, they're an alcoholic, and I don't know what to do about it. And I said, you know what, all you can do is love them and do your best to encourage them, because they're probably going to have to be brought really low before they decide to turn. Because I guarantee you, you telling them to turn will never work. And them doing it for you will never work. They've got to do it for them. And they won't do it until they're brought low. A good friend of mine was a deputy sheriff up in the panhandle. Loved him. He and I would go out witnessing a lot and sharing. He was mean, though, to people who were old drunks, because he was an old drunk. We'd visit with an old drunk, and he'd tell them that. He'd say, the person would say, you know, I drank a little bit, and I got a little problem with that. And they'd say, you're just an old drunk, and you're going to hell. I think, God, can we be a little more diplomatic about this? He'd say, no, you need to tell them what the truth is, Jimmy. They're an old drunk and they're just going to hell. And he'd tell them that. And he'd say, you want to hear about how to get saved? And he'd say, no. And he'd say, well, you can just go on to hell then. And he'd leave. And I'd say, that was not a good way to keep the door open, you know, for us to come back later for this, you know. He told me the story of him becoming a recovering drunk and finding the Lord Jesus. He was a preacher's kid. That's why he had such bitterness about the church, even, because being a preacher's kid, lots of preacher's kids end up that way. End up being a deputy sheriff, but long story short, he ended up in his own jail, having soiled himself, and they just let him lay in it. And his own deputies came in and laughed at him, laying in that cell. And he said, I needed that. Because I decided I wasn't going to be here. I wasn't going to stay here. I was going to get out of this cell. I was going to get myself cleaned up, and I was not going to drink anymore. And he said, Jimmy, it's one day at a time, as all will tell him. But he had to decide. He said, Jimmy, yeah, thank God that I was thrown in that cell and that those deputies laughed at me, because it turned me. The oldest tree in the world is a tree called Methuselah. Do you know about it? It's a Great Basin pine that's found in the mountains of Eastern California. It's 4,850 years old. Methuselah. It's an old tree. Older than Jesus. Older than Abraham. They take a cross-section of that tree, which eventually they have, and just trimming it. You can see all the good and the bad years in the tree line. It's a fantastic thing. I was a horticulturist for a long time, and every time I'd cut down a tree, I always wanted to spend a little time looking at that stump. There's an old tree over here in one of the parks that got cut down, and I'm going to go spend a little time just looking at that stump. And I haven't got the stump pulled up yet, but I want to look at the lines. I want to know how old that tree is. It's an old oak tree like what we've got out here. In the good years, there's lots of growth. In the bad years, there's not very much growth. The year's growth is, and each line can be seen in that tree. The same thing is true of our lives. There are good years and there are bad years, if they were to take a cross-section of us and look at it. That's God's uncomfortable grace. He's always there for us, but His grace is uncomfortable. It's uncomfortable grace to repent and to turn around and quit drinking. Or to leave alone those other obsessions that we have, and all of us have a major obsession. To leave it alone and to turn and let Jesus master it is not an easy thing. But it's something that has to be has to take place. That's God's grace. It's an uncomfortable grace. Taking us somewhere, growing us through the good and the bad, a great mystery, but nevertheless a story to be told. I love listening to people's testimonies. I have this vision of the kingdom of God when we get there. One of the things that we'll be doing is that we'll get to go around, because we'll have eternity to do it, but to actually sit down with people and to hear their story. Tell me your story of how you came to the place that you knew that you were lost and came to know who Jesus was, and then what happened after that. And it's an amazing story each time we hear it from somebody, because each story is so very, very different, and each story has its own little uniquenesses to it that make it wonderful, and we're often surprised at their stories. I've often had times of revival where I ask the members of the church, each night of the revival, one of you are going to come up and give your testimony. We may do that here one of these days, you know. You're going to have to get up and share your testimony. And you can be amazed sometimes to find out what background people had, that you've been going to church with them for a long time, didn't know the kind of life that they had before they became a Christian, and then becoming a Christian, how that happened. Two passages before we leave. Out of Colossians chapter 1, these verses. Now I rejoice in what I have suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions, for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To this end I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. And then one other passage from the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. These words out of 2 Corinthians. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And all this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has commanded us the message. He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. You and I are being perfected in our journey with him. And that journey is a difficult one. No one can describe exactly what's going to happen and what's yet to happen in each of our lives. But God has destined it. He has revealed himself, and in his uncomfortable grace, he's brought you a long way. Give him thanks for it today. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for that uncomfortable grace. It's hard to do, Father, but it's something that we learn to do, to thank you that difficulties have come our way, and that through those difficulties, you have brought us a long way. Father, we're coming through some difficulties even now. The church is going through difficulties. We're struggling. But Lord Jesus, we know that you have purpose in all that you allow. And you're allowing this to find ourselves living at the end of this, Lord, if so be your will that we do live through it. Then, Father, we'll see the magnificent way that your uncomfortable grace has manifested itself in ways that we don't even know about right now. We pray earnestly your help, Lord. In these quiet moments, as the music plays, I just want you to contemplate that walk that you have with the Lord Jesus. And even maybe some of the uncomfortable grace that he has allowed you to face here lately. And give him a commitment in your heart. Lord, I'll endure. I'll stick with you. I'll keep walking with you. I'll keep walking with the church. Doing our best, Lord, to bring the kingdom into the world. Help us do it. You pray for just a few moments and talk to God while the music plays. And we'll dismiss in a prayer here in a moment and have our business meeting. If you do have a decision to make, I'll be here. Come forward and we'll have a time of prayer. Something that you're concerned about, a worry that you have, or a change that's taken place that you need God's help with, you come on up. We'll pray about it.